I'd like to welcome everyone, and I'm pleased to see that we have over 120 registrants for this webinar with community partners, industry stakeholders, and municipal partners coming together to understand the city's changing diabetes program and to hear about the new global healthy food challenge. Diabetes is a disease that has significant health and economic challenges. Many of you know that 2021 marks the 100th anniversary of the discovery of insulin at the University of Toronto. And it is in the spirit of that innovation that we're looking at new ways to address those challenges. The unfortunate reality is that type 2 diabetes in Mississauga and across the region of Peel is 40% higher than the provincial average. That means one in six of our residents live with type 2 diabetes in our city and our region. The pandemic has added to the anxieties around diabetes, and a third of Canadians are saying that they are more concerned about diabetes more than ever, according to the new Ipsos poll conducted by Diabetes Canada this month. The poll shows that 6 out of 10 Canadians believe that having diabetes puts them at greater risk of contracting COVID-19. A majority of Canadians who were surveyed, 86% to be exact, believe that governments should be doing more to prevent or manage diabetes with a nationwide strategy. And this is why I'm so pleased today to welcome back Professor Napier, who is joined by Niels Lund from Novo Nordisk and Dr. Faith Foreman-Hayes from the Houston Public Health.
What I want to talk about is to talk about the City's Changing Diabetes Program. And because I am the global lead for the program and have been that for quite a few years. Because as the mayor mentioned, diabetes is rising at an alarming rate around the world. And just over the last two decades, prevalence has more than doubled. And one of the good things about that is we're keeping more people with diabetes alive, but the uptick or the increase in the number of people living with diabetes continues to grow, and it's continuing. So by mid-century, there will be more than 700 million people with diabetes on this planet, everywhere. This is no longer a rich man's disease or a first world problem. This is a problem that we see everywhere, and it's something that we need to do something about. And treating our way out of the problem is not the way. We need to bend the curve, as the mayor also mentioned, and we believe through the City's Changing Diabetes Program that this has to be done in partnership. And since 2014, Novo Nordisk, University College London, and the Steno Diabetes Center in Copenhagen have worked with hundreds and hundreds of partners around the world to see how we can find solutions to one of these great healthcare threats. Because if COVID, and I'll come back to COVID, is a pandemic in fast motion, diabetes is one in slow motion. So why cities, you might ask? Diabetes is everywhere, and that is true, but there's something going on in cities that requires to take a particular look at cities and how they address the diabetes. Because just slightly more than half of the world's population today live in cities, but already now 2 out of 3 people living with diabetes live in cities. So there's an overrepresentation of people living with diabetes in cities. What is unique about this public-private partnership is that it's evidence-based, it's coalition-based, one of the key benefits of this is that we're trying to understand social and cultural determinants of health to design the best interventions. So this is, you know, there's a double-edged sword in urban environments. Urban centers is where you see growing prosperity, we see innovations, a lot of new things coming to our lives, and therefore cities are both the problem but also the solution. We see through increased urbanization over the last many decades that people are also applying a lifestyle, either voluntarily or not, that influences the way that they live and also produces a sedentary lifestyle. And the approach that we have taken in the 36 cities that are part of the program is, first, we set an ambition. You saw the curves before. We can model how they look in each city. Then we map the challenge, both by understanding from a quantitative as well as from a qualitative point of view, and particularly from a social determinant of health point of view, what the real challenges are. We work, as I said, coalition-based, because we believe that by bringing in more views, solutions will be better. And then we, of course, we want to move this more from just analysis and coalition building in also into driving action to benefit the people that we are talking about. I think we consistently found across the cities that are part of the program that there are five factors that are, or five principles that are important to improve urban health. And they are outlined here. We call it the Urban Diabetes Declaration. But it is investing in the promotion of health and well-being. It's addressing social and cultural determinants and strive for health equity. We need to work to address the health challenges of the most vulnerable citizens in the city. It's evident that health must be integrated into all policies. I think that is also a key learning from COVID-19. And we want to and must engage communities to ensure a sustainable health solution. We also found that in some cities where formal health systems fail, community organizations and community factors and community engagement is actually the last resort for health responses. And therefore, this is a part of an important safety net. And then finally, creating solutions in partnership across sectors is evident.
You'll find this tool, our Urban Diabetes Action Framework. And what this does is it's a tool for creating impactful interventions to prevent diabetes and obesity and promote well-being. And what we do here is that we bring together the extensive resources that are available from cities that want to implement action frameworks. And we not only use it as a way of trying to share what we've learned in cities changing diabetes over the past 6 years, but also to build on the actual experiences of partners within the program. And this is what the website looks like. If you go to Cities Changing Diabetes, you can find the interactive PDF, and it's really quite well developed. And I highly recommend, if you want to find out what we're all about, that you go ahead and do that.
As one of the original three cities from 2014. In Houston, we have a lot of experience under our belt, including the experience of working with Niels at Novo Nordisk in Denmark and his colleagues in the United States. Since I'm representing Houston, or what we call affectionately H-Town, it is appropriate for me to begin with a quote from our mayor and a few words from him. And as you can see, we are so appreciative of his leadership in championing cities changing diabetes. And he's actually been our champion from the very beginning of his taking office. Here in Houston, over 400 people have participated in multiple cities changing diabetes events. And almost 100 people have participated in our action phase by developing interventions, collaborating on implementing them, funding and sustaining them. These include people living with diabetes, caregivers, healthcare professionals, and a myriad of nonprofits, from business associations to grassroots organizations. These action work groups are self-organized. This photo that you're seeing on the screen right now was taken from our very first event with communities of faith at our Faith and Diabetes Summit that we held back in 2016. This summit was really about understanding how health ministries and houses of faith could get more active in diabetes prevention and management. Now here, this is our model that we use here in Houston and how we actually built our model. This is our process, and we took the research from Dr. Linder, and taking that research, involving community members and organizational stakeholders, and getting them to translate the research and co-create solutions that are currently being implemented and sustained locally. One other initiative that I wanted to share is something called Faith in Diabetes. And this is one of our other very strong initiatives that's actually been replicated in other parts of the world. Actually, they're replicating it, I believe, in Philadelphia and also in Leicester in England. So it's been wonderful. This picture shows our cohort of congregational leaders. And that is what Faith in Diabetes is about. It's about a curriculum, a concept where we can train congregational leaders in houses of faith to impact those congregants who are living with diabetes, trying to manage or prevent diabetes in their own house of faith. So this picture represents the first graduating class of that Faith in Diabetes curriculum and cohort. And in this photo, you're actually seeing the graduates who represent people from the Muslim, Hindu, and 8 different Christian communities of faith. So we're very proud of and happy that this is being replicated around the world.